V&A has a strong Calcutta connection because it came up as a decorative museum dedicated to the modern period, which simply meant it did have a lot of objects from Calcutta. But today, the reason for rejoicing is that Kalighat represents, as all of you know, the most plebeian form of folk art of the city. It is a folk art of the most street variety, the lowest strata. And the fact that 150 years later, the empire and the world has recognized it for all its worth is its artistic qualities, the confident bold strokes. When you go and see, you won't see a quiver in the stroke. It's one simple bold stroke. Hungry men don't make too many mistakes. It's a precursor of modern art, as has been said, and I will not get into any artistic description here or describing the form of art. It's for you to go and appreciate. The world has finally come around. There is a certain amount of conversion from different art forms, but then as I said, I want to resist the temptation of starting any description of the form of art. The themes are also, as you will see, very, very Calcutta oriented. It has a lot of the soul, it's captured a lot of the soul of 19th century Calcutta. And one of the things that will catch your attraction is the Bengali obsession for the fish. The fish is central to very much of it. Having said that, I remember how 30, 35 years ago, my gurus, Radha Prasad Gupta, R.P. Gupta, Shatul Gupta, Mulk Raj Anand, Shubha Thakur and others, took me around this place and other places to introduce. And today, we have been successful in making their dream come true, because this collection that you see is largely drawn from two great collections of the Victoria and Albert Museum. The first comes from the Lockwood Kipling collection. Lockwood Kipling was the father of Rudyard Kipling. I'll come to that a little later. And from the collection of the Mukulde and others from Calcutta. So it actually, in a way, they have come back home. And they have now been exhibited with the best of Kalighat dots of the Victoria Memorial. Calcutta has one of those rare bursts of creative energy that one will not see in any part of the world. Ladies and gentlemen, when I make these comparisons, I make them with some degree of comfort, some degree of knowing what's going on. Creativity is there in every part of the world, but the creativity of the folk and the people that one sees coming out over a burst, as I say, creative volcano, during the Durga Pujas is something to be seen, to be believed. If you observe carefully, from the idols, every material goes into the making of the idols. This style, every style from the traditional to the outlandish, the pandals or the structures, from their replicas of the Eiffel Tower to the Big Ben, everything else, to the interior which replicates to the finest detail, the best of creative talents, miracles in cloth as I say at times, the themes. Now, every year, popular imagination is at its height with absolute support from the millions and millions of citizens of Calcutta. I have wondered and I've asked my mother, I keep asking the same question to you. I know it's religion, but why do we immerse all of it on the fifth day? Maybe we could take a look around. I'm sure there'll be a way to get around this religious part. I feel that some of it is worth retaining back in some form of a museum. I have a dream. Can't we all find out a disused jute mill or something like that in the suburbs where we could go on collecting, subject to religious sanction? I don't want to get into that tricky subject. Subject to that part being taken care of. Justice Mukherjee is here. I'm sure he will find some way out for us. But the tremendous amount of creative energy that comes out during the Durga Pujas in Calcutta, some of it should be retained back for posterity. It's just an idea. Can we now take this joint exhibition that displays the best of Calcutta's folk art, not only to the four cities of India, but cities abroad as well? We haven't decided upon it. It's my request. And if you support it, give it a clap. Thank you very much.